Hello, loyal viewers and people who have arrived from Collins at AMSAT, because this episode's about you. That's the reason why you're watching. This is episode 151. Yes, the Collins Collectors Association and some more stuff on the Fox One satellite, all from the Dayton Hamvention. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, over my shoulder, Arvin, the piggy bank, HamRadioNow.tv, if you like the program. That's all we got to say about that. Let's see what's going on here. This guy is Bill Carnes, N7OTQ. He is the president of the Collins Collectors Association, and we'll talk to him in a moment. Asking him perhaps the most difficult question I have ever asked a guest on Ham Radio Now. That'll be at the end of the interview, so heck, to hang around for that. And let's see, these guys, there on the left is Keith Baker, KB1SF. Keith is the AMSAT North America Executive Vice President. And on his right is Burns Fisher, W2BFJ. He's the Fox One Satellite Software Team co-leader. Come on, you guys. I can't fit all that on the bottom of the screen. I need shorter titles. So then we'll do the AMSAT one second, and the Collins guys will be first. Let's go to Dayton. So we are in the Collins Collector Association booth. The first thing I have to do, who are you?
My name's Bill Carnes. I'm currently the president of the Collins Collectors Association.
Okay, the first thing I have to do is apologize, because in a couple of years ago at Dayton, I was doing this kind of show, and I walked up to the Collins Collector Association booth, and I only asked one question. There's a Collins Collector Association. Is there also a Collins Emitter and Base Association? He gets the joke.
I have to tell you, I appreciate that, because I have a background in semiconductor technology, and I worked the first half of my career in designing semiconductors. So, yes, I get the joke.
All right. What is the CCA all about?
Collins Collectors Association is, we're celebrating our 20th anniversary this year. In fact, we did that last night. We started out as a users group for Collins Radio users and collectors. And it started out to be a net, then it grew to a website and information about collecting and about technical support. And that has expanded over the years, but in the last 4 or 5 years, we've been specifically expanding beyond just member support. That's still our most important objective. But we have recently aligned ourselves with the Antique Wireless Association and formed the Collins Radio Heritage Group. The Heritage Group supports the AACLA, the Arthur A. Collins Legacy Association in Cedar Rapids, who, among other things, supports the museum, works with the museum, and does archival projects. So we're expanding in...
I'm sorry, what museum?
The Rockwell Collins Museum.
Where is that?
It's in Cedar Rapids. That's the corporate museum for Rockwell Collins.
Okay. Is that a public museum, or is that kind of closed up?
It is, and it's within the company, but you can, if you request tours on certain days, you can go through it. The Antique Wireless Museum in Bloomfield, New York, of course, is open. But we are now much broader, and our objectives are to preserve the history of not only Collins Radio, but a dominant and important technology corporation in this country. And the end game in that is to use that archived material and that information base to get to children in the impressionable age, sixth grade, seventh grade, eighth grade in the STEM program, and stimulate kids to go into the sciences. So the purpose...
That may be the last thing I expected of this interview to go to.
I think you probably did not expect that. Our objectives are much broader now than just supporting the membership, and it's proving to be a lot of fun, and it's proving to be quite effective so far. So the end game is, in several years, we want to have technology puzzles, smartphone apps, iPad, Kindle apps for kids, and have kids being exposed and stimulated to our historical base, technology base, and to current technologies so that they can get involved in the sciences in school.
So as I was coming up here thinking, well, what am I going to ask you guys about? The future of what you do was going to be a part of it. Turns out you beat me to it. Because Collins, of course, is venerable. You know, venerable is probably the number one word everybody uses. It's got a significant history of as some of the highest end equipment in the early days of ham radio, and for a good long time, but then left the ham radio market. So I was going to say, what's the future for a group like this? Is there a way to interest new hams and young people in Collins Radio? And I think you've figured out how to do that, or at least you're going to try.
That is also one of our purposes. Obviously, what happens along the way with the STEM work is kids get interested in amateur radio. They get interested, more importantly, in technology in general. And I think that is one of our important future purposes and part of our direction in the future.
Now, there's still a lot of Collins equipment on the air, but it's probably getting harder and harder to keep it going?
Interestingly enough, there are some challenges. Tubes is not one of them. There's pretty good new old stock tube supply in the world, and there are still manufacturers. The most challenging part of it is the electrolytics. Electronics today, the supply voltages have shrunk from hundreds of volts to 50 volts to 15 volts in the 60s to 5 volts, then to 3 volts, then to 1.5 volts. Electrolytic manufacturers are now, in general, manufacturing capacitors in the 3 volt range, 5 volt range, 50 volt range. 300 volt electrolytics are getting kind of hard to come by.
And they fail.
The new ones don't if you can get them, but the electrolytics do fail, yes.
I mean, the old ones, the original ones they put in.
And so that's probably our biggest challenge. But in general, because of, you see a lot of people paranoid about electrolytics. I personally have about 80 pieces of Collins gear running, and I've been collecting Collins for many, many years. And I have actually changed very, very few capacitors. The quality of the original equipment is just significant. And it does, if you take care of it, if you store it well, if you use it regularly, it lasts a long time.
Are younger hams and newer hams getting interested in Collins just for the heritage, just to see where things came from?
Yes, that's a question that comes up very often. People who are not really aware of what's going on think that the more appliance operator-oriented modern radio operators are not going to be interested. The people that grew up not even knowing what a tube is are not going to be that interested. But in fact, we're finding quite the opposite. Our membership, in a time when club membership has been going down, particularly during the recession after 2008, a lot of clubs struggled with membership. Our membership has almost doubled in the last 3 years. Part of it, I think, is because of what we're doing. People like what we're doing. But part of it is also because there is an interest, just like someone is interested in collecting antique furniture and the heritage of the aura that comes along with that. They are interested in the old radios, and we get people coming in and starting to collect Collins who don't know what a tube is. But they're interested in it because of its heritage, because of the impact that Arthur Collins had, that Collins Radio had, the quality. They are interested in it. So surprisingly, we're actually getting a lot of younger new members that are coming on board, and they're learning very quickly. It's amazing. They ask some fairly naive questions at first.
Just
fundamentally, my radio is broken. What's wrong with it? You know, and that's kind of a difficult question to answer. But we lead them through how to diagnose and how to look at the radio and how to signal trace. And pretty soon, I'm surprised, we have a reflector that's kind of like a chat room where people can get support, give support, put things for sale, look for things. And I see regularly people, I'll see them come on like 2 years ago, and they'll be asking very naive questions. 2 years later, they're answering support questions.
And these radios are all very repairable, very workable. You can get in and do stuff if you can get the parts.
That's one of the beauties of them, yes. And I like to, and this was kind of one of the fun moments in my operating. I have a background in electronics. I like troubleshooting. And I was operating one night talking to someone on the air, and while they were transmitting, my receiver quit, cold as a stone. And I reached out and I turned the audio gain up and down. I still had hum when it was way up. I turned the RF gain up and down. I saw the S meter move. I knew which AGC circuits were working. I changed all of the controls, and by the time in my head, I had it isolated to two stages. I opened the lid, I reached in, and I felt those two tubes. One of them was cold. I jerked it, ran in my parts room, grabbed a tube, plugged it in, and by the time he turned it over to me, I was back on the air.
Now, rapid repair.
You cannot do that with a solid-state radio.
No, that radio is probably going back or...
It's going back to the factory, if in fact it's repairable. So I would venture that 50 years later, because of the VLSI and because of the custom integrated circuits, it's not going to be repairable.
How's the value of Collins' historic equipment doing? Is it going up constantly?
It's going up, yes.
But you have to keep good care of it.
Well, if you let it go to pot, then yes, it's going to go down in value. But if you take care of it, I won't say it's a good investment. That's not what we're here for. In many cases, it turns out to be an okay investment. But in terms of preserving your money, in terms of having fun, it's a good value.
Somebody will acquire one of these, and they might not have very much expertise in what it takes to keep the value up and keep things going. You don't want to just put it on a desk someplace and let it sit. What do you have to do to keep its value and its condition up?
Store it in a nice environment and use it. Most important thing is to use it.
Use it?
Yes.
Don't just let it sit there.
Don't just let it sit. If you let it sit, the capacitors are going to dry up. They're going to need reforming. And contacts will get to the point where they need cleaning. Switches need to be exercised. Tube pin contacts need to be exercised. So, yes.
Turn it on a few hours a day or leave it on all the time?
No. I just turn it on and off once in a while and use it just the way you regularly would.
Interesting. Anything else about the Collectors Association I haven't asked you that is a burning thing to say?
I think we've kind of covered it. I would invite anyone that's interested in Collins or interested in the technology history of the company, of the country, to look at our website. There's a lot of information there, a lot of support information. In general, we make all of our support free. You don't have to be a member to use our resources. Basically, what you get for being a member is knowing that you're helping to support us and a pretty nice magazine. We're very proud of what we've done with the magazine over the last 10 years.
Okay, what's the website?
Collinsradio.org. Very simple.
Got that a long time ago.
Yep.
And how often does the magazine come out? The
magazine comes out quarterly, unlike most club magazines, it's a 80-pound book gloss, UV-coated, very nice, high-quality magazine, and typically runs about 24 to 28 pages. Last year, it got as big as 52 pages. So it's a magazine up there in quality with QST, for instance.
Sounds good. And you have some on-the-air activities?
We have nets. We have a fundamental net that's been running for 20 years is our Sunday afternoon net at 2000 Zulu, yes. 263.
Do you do anything in terms of contests or special events?
We really don't do a lot of contesting or special events. We do support some historical special events. For instance, recently in the last year, we were associated with and helped with the restoration of the B-29 Fifi radio room, bringing it up to its original configuration. That effort was done by the Rockwell Collins Group out of Cedar Rapids and Dallas, fundamentally, did a great job of it. But we helped them with the scheduling, with flight scheduling, and some of the technical work in the background. And now when Fifi flies, we put that up on our website so our members can work the radio room. And
a lot of Collins equipment in there. Was it mostly Collins?
The transmitter was Collins. It was the infamous ART-13, ATC ART-13. And the receiver was the ubiquitous BC-348.
Yeah, Collins started with mostly transmitters. It was a while before they did receivers.
That's very true. A lot of people don't realize that. Art started a transmitting and component company, and he didn't actually introduce his first receiver until about 1938.
So, Bill, you've got some pieces of equipment in a sort of a timeline that you wanted to show me.
Yes.
Let me give you the microphone, and you just carry it and show me what you got.
I think that testimony to the structural strength of Collins radio equipment and to the progress of technology through the years, right here on the table, you're looking at 60 years of history of Collins radio equipment. And of course, centered here, because we are amateur radio-centric, is the ubiquitous S-line, a KWM-2, the 312B5 station control, and the 30L1 amplifier. These are from roughly 1964, let's say. They were introduced in late 59, 60, but this equipment is probably from around 1964. Over here to the left, this is one of the first transmitter exciters that Arthur Collins built. This happens to be the prototype 10B exciter, and it's from about 1934. So we have 1934, 1964, and then a 671 U4A, which is a gorgeous airborne HF comm receiver exciter, and its control head. And these are very useful for amateur radio applications. Wonderful receiver, a just absolutely high performance transmitter exciter that puts out 500 milliwatts and can drive any of the airborne or ground amplifiers that Collins had that took 500 milliwatts in. So right there in one sweep of the hand, we have 60 years of history of Collins radio equipment. And you can just take one look at it and see what happened over those 60 years and also see the wonderful quality.
Cliff tells me we're just about out of tape. I got time for one quick question. What is the one most significant or important piece of equipment that came out of Collins in ham radio?
Oh, my gosh. That's a difficult...
You're going to make somebody mad answering this.
Yeah, no matter what I say here, I'm going to be wrong. But I would say the KWS-1 transmitter for several reasons. First of all, it's a glorious piece of engineering work. It was the first significant high-power single sideband transmitter to be announced. And as importantly, in the background, Art was working with Butch Griswold and Kurt LeMay, generals in the Air Force, and what they were really doing was developing the single sideband SAC communication capability that helped save our country from a nuclear accident. Few people know that during that time period in the early 50s, when SAC bombers had gone on orbital patrol and were at the end of their range, they were at the end of their communication range. And when they were launched, if they had been launched on a nuclear strike, there was no way to recall them.
Wow.
And they solved that problem with single sideband communication. And the KWS-1 was part of that saga. And so I would, you could wave your arms and say some of the S-line was in production longer, much higher volume, and be right. But I would answer with the KWS.
And for some good reasons. Thank you very much.
Okay, nice talking with you, Gary. Thank you.
I was going to introduce the Collins segment as just a bunch of old farts trying to keep some, well, admittedly, really first-class equipment running. But they have gone way beyond that. Good for you guys. All right, back to Dayton, and we'll talk to the AMSAT guys, and we'll learn some more interesting stuff about the Fox 1 satellite.
We are at AMSAT, and who am I speaking to?
I'm Burns Fisher, W2BFJ.
And Keith Baker, KB1SF.
All right. Last year, we did an interview with Tony Montero.
Yes.
So introduce yourselves. Who am I talking to?
Hi, I'm Tony Montero. I'm the VP of Engineering for AMSAT.
AA2TX.
AA2TX.
Yes.
All right.
Tony Montero has passed away, and I wanted to acknowledge that right away, and I choke up. You've done something. That's the Fox 1 satellite that he was talking to us about.
Yeah. This is the Fox 1 satellite, full-scale model. This is what we use to make sure
that,
everything, we use this to make sure that everything fits, right?
Yes.
And also to get the weight and the mass correct. And also this will be what we use to test, to do the final testing of the satellite before we give it over to NASA, who are then going to be the people that launch it.
Okay, so before we get to the details of the satellite, you were showing me something on it for Tony.
Yes. We've etched in the top of the satellite the words in memory of Anthony Montero, AA2TX, may you rest with the stars. So that'll be going on the satellite when we orbit.
Okay, when is the launch estimated now?
We're looking at
next the end of next summer, early next fall, most likely. Could conceivably be earlier, but most likely next fall.
Again, because we have a quote-unquote free launch from NASA under a program called ELANA, which is educational launches. We're piggybacking on an Air Force launch out of Vandenberg. So the main payload, since they're paying the freight, we have to go with them. And so depending on their schedule is when we'll launch. So
yeah, so you've got a specific launch, but they never know exactly when it's going to go until they get close.
Exactly. That's correct.
Yeah, they delay it for their own reasons, and we just say, yes, sir.
Okay, what does this satellite do?
This satellite will be essentially a repeater in the sky. You'll be able, if you have a capability to work on 430 megahertz FM down on 2 meters, which would be 145.
145.
Yeah.
980.
Yeah. And in fact, we've got a transmitter receiver set up here that if you're close enough to the booth, you can come over with your handheld and actually talk through the satellite, these boards.
This is amateur radio satellite, Fox 1 and Amsat.
Okay, there's a countdown to delivery, too.
Yes.
Right, yeah.
More or less.
More or less.
Yeah, this is the date when
we'll be back in here.
More or less.
This is the date when we have to actually stop touching the satellite, put it aside, and our launch providers say, yep, don't touch it after this. We'll take it at a certain date later, but this is the day when we are done.
Okay, so you don't hand it over yet, but they want you to stop tinkering.
That's the way it works.
Because they know hams, right? You'll tinker it until you deliver it.
They know hams, they know computer programmers. Yeah, they understand. Yeah.
You'll have somebody chasing after the rocket saying, one more tweak.
Absolutely, oh yeah.
That's happened on a couple of occasions. Anyway, the other thing, if you notice here, if you can look at this, this little antenna thing, this is the 450 antenna. And you'll notice it's got a piece of fishing line tied to the end of it. When the satellite is launched, it's inside this tube, and we'll use this piece of fishing line to secure it.
I'll hold it. You can wrap it around if you want.
Yeah, you just wrap it around. And so what will happen is there's a little heater in there, a little resistive heater, that will burn through the fishing line, and then it deploys.
Oh, man, that better work.
It's rather simple, but we've done this in the past. And some of our other satellites, we've actually used Carpenter's rule. And that has been used on a couple of occasions where we'll paint one side black and we'll paint the other side white. And what that does in orbit is it gives the satellite a spin to give it about a 1 revolution per minute spin. Because remember, when we're in orbit, a lot of people say, well, all I have to do is get a couple of handhelds and stick them in a box and send them up there to launch. Well, unfortunately, you got to remember where this is going. There's no heat sinks in space. There's no, fans will not work. So the only way you can move heat around inside the spacecraft is through direct contact. So what that means is that we have to design this satellite to handle not only being baking in the sun at 250 degrees Celsius, and when it goes behind the Earth in that part of the orbit, it's minus 250 degrees Celsius. So we have to build the satellite to be able to handle that kind of a temperature swing. And that creates a problem because the satellite, these little CubeSats are very, very small. In fact, this whole design was the brainchild of another gentleman who's an AMSAT member many, many years ago, still is, named Bob Twiggs. He was out at Stanford University and partnered with a gentleman that worked with him and came up with this concept of these CubeSats. There's now hundreds of these things being launched. And so here's another
example. Not all ham radio.
Not all ham radio. A lot of them are universities, satellites. There's also a good number of government satellites. But this is a classic example of where amateur radio has in many ways created another design for a piece of electronic equipment that in fact now has become a standard for commercial operations.
Can we say that this CubeSat design absolutely originated in ham radio?
Yes, because it was a ham that came up with it.
Well, was he working for a big company, or was he designing it for AMSAT?
He was a university professor. But
and it was a design for ham radio for AMSAT?
Well, it was designed as a design that he came up with, yes, to start with. So
I'm trying to nail you to the wall here.
Yeah,
can we claim this for ham radio?
I think we can. I think we can make a good case that it was. Okay. Let's say it came out of the brains of a ham.
After all, he knows about our ham radio problems in launching satellites.
That's exactly.
So whether or not he expected us to launch one first, it's a different question, but it certainly was in his head.
Yeah.
Okay.
The thing is, the cost of launch now has become almost prohibitive for a nonprofit type organization. It used to be that you could launch, and we've launched satellites for maybe $20,000 or $30,000, but in many ways, we've become the victims of our own success in that now there's a whole group of people that have come on board to do this themselves. And
no more ballast anymore.
No more ballast, exactly. So, but because we've been able to shrink the size of the components, now you're looking at a lot of surface mount technology. We're able to put into a satellite of this size to have the same capability as a satellite that may be about two or three times its size.
I wanted to mention one thing that you were talking before about the satellite spinning on the Z-axis. Well, one other way that we get it to spin, notice that the solar cells are mounted a little off-center. So this is shiny, and this is less shiny. So what happens when you have sunlight hitting it is that the sunlight bounces off, and a little bit of sun pressure causes it to spin. So I think that's a really cool design.
We also have magnets in the side too, right?
The magnets in the side, yeah, and the magnets are what keeps it pointing, keeps it Earth pointed in the northern hemisphere and opposite Earth pointed in the southern hemisphere, because the magnets line up with the magnetic poles of the Earth.
I'm confused. Is it spinning or is it holding steady?
Yes.
Yes, exactly. What happens is that the magnet here follows the magnetic lines of the Earth, and it tries to line up with the magnetic field of the Earth. So in the Z-axis, it kind of turns around twice per each orbit. In the XY-axis. In the Z-axis, it is spinning slowly like so.
Okay, and the advantage of spinning is what, temperature compensation?
Yes.
Yes, exactly.
It's like a rotisserie. Yeah.
I'm not totally untrainable.
No.
That's great.
It's like a barbecue rotisserie, because remember, this thing's baking in the sun.
Right.
And you know exactly what happens when you take your handheld outside, particularly batteries. And that's the real problem here, is that the battery technology in many ways has not necessarily kept up with the electronic component technology. And so we're still flying NICADs, right?
Yes, NICADs.
But because of the size of this thing doesn't absorb enough heat in the sun, we're having to put little heaters around the NICADs to keep them warm. If you've ever been outside with a camera in a cold Canadian winter, you know that it doesn't work very well. The batteries don't work very well. So that's the other thing that we've had to do.
So it's worth taking a little juice from the battery to keep itself warm.
To keep it warm, so that the batteries will take a charge when they are in the sun.
Yep.
But again, this is full size, by the way. I don't know if we said that, but this is a full size.
People should understand you're 9 feet tall.
That's right, exactly. Correct.
Yeah. This is 10 centimeters, sort of 4 inches.
Yeah.
And it's 1.3 kilograms or something like that, so 2.5 or so pounds, which you know, in one way it's not very heavy, but in another way it's pretty dense when you look at something this size.
Also, if we were paying for this launch, we're looking at about what, $35,000-$40,000?
Oh yeah.
And we're getting that donated to us by NASA because it's an educational, it'll be used for educational purposes. You notice there's a little camera here too. We'll be taking pictures of the Earth from that. That's
what kind of resolution and how do the pictures come down?
It's a VGA camera, so what is that, 480 by 5 something or other. And it comes down on telemetry, but it's a special high-speed telemetry mode that we invented for Fox. So you won't be able to do transponding when it's sending down data. But nonetheless, it's coming down at 9,600 baud.
Is it sort of like a slow scan picture?
It should be a much denser, better quality picture than your typical slow scan. If you saw pictures from AMSAT 1, for example, this is a higher quality picture than that.
What would it take for an individual to decode the telemetry in the pictures?
If you want to turn your camera right over to here, this will be the ground software that we have, and the ground software will have all of the equipment to decode the pictures, decode the telemetry. Right now, this is just a static display, but it'll have all the voltages and currents and temperatures.
What your temperatures are, what your voltages are coming off of the solar panels,
right.
What the battery voltages are.
But to answer your question directly, when it's in data mode, this software will be able to decode it. And of course, the format will all be in the public domain when we.
So it'll be like 9,600 bits.
9,600 bits per second, correct?
Okay, so you need a radio that's capable of giving you an output for that.
Yeah.
A lot of FM radios can.
Yeah, that's the TNC output would typically be okay with that.
We're also designing the satellite into what Tony called the zombie sat mode. One of the problems that we've had with our satellites in the past, in fact, it's not just us, it's anybody that launches into orbit, because of the harsh environment, batteries are usually one of the, we call it the long pole in the tent. The batteries tend to fail usually before the electronics fails. We've had a couple of satellites, one of which we launched in 1974, which is Oscar 7, went silent in about 1981. And not too many moons ago, all of a sudden, one of our gentlemen in England was listening across the satellite bands and heard this beacon, this CW beacon, and said, but it was drifting as if it was had a Doppler shift associated with it. He says, what the heck is that? Turned out it was Oscar 7. What had happened is one of the batteries, instead of shorting closed, had shorted open.
Well, it had been short of closed for decades.
Yeah, decades. And then all of a sudden, that battery opened up, and as soon as the satellite was in, if it was in sunlight, it came on. Well, it's still doing that. So we've purposely designed this satellite to do the same thing, so that if the batteries fail, which they probably will before the satellite deorbits, so we're talking, how many years? 10 or 11-year cycle in orbit. If the batteries fail, unlike our satellite AO51, which was very, very popular FM satellite, this thing will stay open in terms of if the satellite is in sun, it'll be on. If it's in darkness, it'll be off. So that's the zombie sat mode that we're designing.
There's actually another part to that, too, and that is that we don't know what effect the radiation in space will have on our CPU in there. If the CPU, the internal housekeeping unit, the IHU,
that's the onboard
dies.
Computer.
Yeah, exactly, the onboard computer. If the onboard computer dies, then we'll go into a completely carrier-operated autonomous mode without any processing. Of course, you don't have telemetry at that point. You don't have the pictures or anything, but you still have a repeater.
And did you say it's got a transponder in it for sideband and CW or just FM?
Just FM. This one will be just FM, but we've got another launch. Another Atlanta launch that we've been, they've told us that we're going to be able to use. So the follow-on to this is may or may not have sideband in it, but there's all kinds of other opportunities coming down the road.
I believe I discussed this with Tony. That's why it's Fox 1, not Fox.
That's right. Yeah. This is Fox 1. In fact, you could even say this is Fox 1A.
Yeah, there's a Fox 1B as well that we have a grant for. We aren't assigned specifically to a launch. It will be nearly identical to this, same radios and so on, but with different student experiments in it. that one will
I've only got a couple of minutes left to get an answer on this. Over the winter, I was hearing about some launch of, I don't know, dozens, hundreds of tiny little satellite chip sort of things, and I understand it also, it didn't work, right?
The satellite was called KickSat, and it was funded by the Kickstarter website. And the intent was to have hundreds, as you say, of just little tiny chips, which had a little transmitter on it, and they could do some particular thing. Transmit.
Yeah, if I'd have been able to do a show about that, the title would have been, "Your Satellites Are Blocking My View of Space."
right. Yeah, that's funny. Yeah, right. But yeah, the timer didn't apparently work, so they didn't release it. It was at the space station altitude, so it's not a very long life orbit for a little thing like that.
It's like our AMSAT. It was about 6 months.
Yeah, exactly. Right.
Yeah, they wouldn't want those things floating up there very long.
No.
They become trapped.
No,
absolutely not.
But the thing is that they don't have time to fix it after the timer failed.
Yeah.
So no KickSats until next time.
No KickSats until next time, most likely.
All right. Well, thank you, guys. I appreciate the update.
Appreciate what you do, Gary. You do an awful lot for amateur radio, and we appreciate the opportunity to talk about what we like to do in our little corner of amateur radio. But this is a fantastic hobby. There's just so many pieces to it. There's so many different things that you can do, and if you get tired of one thing, you can always do something else. If anybody's interested, we're at amsat.org, AMSAT.org. There's a lot of information up there. There's a whole series of beginner articles if people are interested. And, you know, they always say, well, it's too hard. I've never been able to do this. We're trying as much as we can to help people get started.
And it's a great thing that a radio club with one or two experts can help mentor the rest of the club.
Absolutely. Right. And that's the key. That's the key to the whole thing. In fact, we've got a whole group of mentors as well that'll help people get started on the satellites. And there's also links up there on the webpage that can do that.
Okay. Thank you, guys. Enjoy the rest of the show and relax.
Thank you.
Take care.
And as Tony would say, we're always hiring.
Yeah, we're an equal opportunity exploiter, as we say. Thanks, Gary.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Very nice of you. That's it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. Once again, Arvin back there overseeing the financial situation of Ham Radio Now. So stop by the website, hamradionow.tv. If you've enjoyed the program, you guys who came from Collins and AMSAT. Well, the Collins guys, they left a long time ago. It's the AMSAT guys who may still be watching. There's 149, 150 other episodes out there to watch and almost 200 actual individual programs. So go tune in. And then stop by hamradionow.tv and click on Arvin. Thanks to my senior executive producer and camera toter, Cliff Broughton, W1W1. Moving you to New England, Cliff, sorry. You want to move out west. W4FT. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, your host and editor and all that. Editor, yeah. See, this is the editing system. Those are the buttons that I push when I'm not sitting here in front of the recording system and talking to you. So goodbye. Over and out.